Hey, I'm Brendan, and today we're going to talk about service mesh. So when we think about technologies, containers and container orchestration sort of came first, but one of the things that came after was the idea of a service mesh. And I want to explain to people how it works and why you might consider using it. So traditionally, when we think about load balancing, we think about north-south load balancing, meaning I have a user out here somewhere, and they put traffic into a gateway of some stripe. This might be an ingress in Kubernetes. And that leads down to your pods. What a service mesh is actually talking about is more like east-west load balancing, which means I have a service here, S1, and I want to talk to some other service, S2. How do I make traffic go between those two things? Now, when you're talking about the mesh itself, there's a couple of different values that it brings to the table. The first is that many of these meshes install as sidecars. So if you imagine you have your main pod, you have your app container, and then you have a mesh sidecar that is a separate container within the same pod, and they talk to each other on localhost. Now, what this means is that as an application developer, I don't actually necessarily have to link something in. I don't have to think very much about how to integrate the service mesh into my application. I just add its container to my pod definition, and the services sort of show up automatically. And because this is all happening on localhost, I don't need to worry about certificates or any other kind of authentication because the network traffic is all limited to the inside of the pod. So you can let the app developer focus on developing their app, let the service mesh take care of sort of proxying traffic out to the rest of the world. Now, what are the sort of main characteristics that a service mesh provides to you as an application developer? Well, there's three. The first is a notion of authorization, which basically says service authorization. Which basically says, well, if I'm service one, can I talk to service two? And on the other side, if I'm service one, can service three talk to me? So the service mesh can allow you to, in a declarative way, define the services that are allowed to talk to your service and the services that your service are allowed to talk to. That's pretty useful in terms of, you know, establishing least privilege and other sorts of access control in the building of your application. It's also actually really useful in terms of preventing accidents, because you can't have a development service accidentally put too much traffic onto your production instance. So if auth is the first thing that a service mesh provides, the second thing that a service mesh provides is the idea of experiments or canary. So if I'm service one and I'm going to talk to service two, there may be two different versions of service two. There may be service two and there may be service two v2, which is the next version of the service that I'm going to roll out. Now, I might want to do an experiment and say, okay, I want, you know, 99% of my traffic to go to the production, I know it works version of service two, but I want to do a 1% experiment to send traffic to this other version, to test for a while. Maybe it's to see which one, if it works correctly. Maybe there's a new implementation down here. You want to make sure it's still performant. There's a variety of reasons why you might want to do this sort of canary testing to minimize the impact of any change that you might make before you complete a rollout. And the service mesh actually enables you to do that, because again, over here in the sidecar, it's proxying for you. And when it's doing that proxy, it can send 99% of the traffic in one direction and 1% of the traffic in the other. And what's important is the application doesn't even know the difference. You didn't have to reconfigure your application at all in order to achieve this kind of experimentation. The third thing that the service mesh provides for you is that if you have your app and you have the service mesh and it's talking through that proxy, this proxy can actually collect a lot of metrics. It can collect metrics like latency, like HTTP errors, user agents, and many other metrics that are useful to you, and then push those things into a metric server, like Azure Monitoring or a, you know, open source project like Prometheus. So you can actually, without instrumenting your application at all, you can actually get really targeted metrics about, If you're throwing 500s, how long is a particular request taking? What kind of clients are talking to you? Again, without modifying your code at all and simply by adding in this service mesh sidecar. Now, when we talk about actually using a service mesh, the interesting question is, well, what APIs should I use? And one of the things we've developed in conjunction with a variety of other people in the container space is this idea of the service mesh interface, or SMI. The SMI is a collection of APIs that register themselves with Kubernetes. And then there are providers that implement those things. So you can have Console implement those APIs. You can have Istio implement those APIs. You can have Linkerd implement those APIs. And what this allows you to do is standardize tooling and your own production experience on top of an API that isn't tightly bound to any particular implementation, which means that in different environments, perhaps in Azure versus on the edge, you can make different decisions. Or if you come to a place where a particular implementation isn't working for you or you can't get support for it, you can switch implementations without having to rebuild your entire system. So hopefully that gives you a perspective about how service meshes can help you build more reliable applications and how you can use SMI to implement that service mesh.